The next speaker is Oliviero Andreussi, and we deliver a talk about plasma controlled light harvesting, design rules for biohybrid devices via multiscale modeling.
First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present this work to this nice audience, and you all for staying here so long in the afternoon after so many talks. And I'd like to show you some work that I've been doing working in the group of Professor Mennucci, the Molecolab here in Pisa, and thanks to the funding of the European Research Council. In particular, I'm going to show you some results on biohybrid devices using multiscale modeling. So I will start, as this is an audience of mostly theoreticians, I will start by describing the model that we are using, which is, of course, a model derived from the PCM model, which I will assume that everybody in the audience knows, and I also thanks some of the speakers before me to introduce. And from the PCM, several lines of research have emerged in the past, and I will show you here a few of them, which are the ones that are mostly pursued in the lab of Professor Mennucci in these days. It doesn't want to be an exhaustive list, and there have been other groups working in, on similar topics. A very important extension of the PCM model is the one regarding the treatment of metal nanoparticles, which originated from the work of Stefano Corni in 2001. The idea here is that, similarly to what PCM does for the solvent, you can also model other objects like nanoparticles simply by considering them as continuum bodies, characterized by their experimental permittivity, so static and optical permittivities. And this model is very simple, as the PCM, but it is very powerful when you want to look at the dielectric response of the metal particles. So you're interested, for example, in the plasmonic properties of the system. Of course, such a model is a very crude approximation if you're looking at chemical interaction between molecules and metal nanoparticles, because of course the metal is treated as a continuum body. But if you look at plasmonic properties, this model is very effective in reproducing the field enhancement effects. So the strong enhancement that are usually called hotspots, that happen when an impinging electric field hit the system. And in particular, what we can do is to look at the response properties of chromophores when they're placed in these regions with a high electric field. And in particular, we can look at the radiative and non-radiative decay rates of excited states, and we can also look at absorption coefficients. I will not go through the details of the equations, but if you are interested, I can answer questions later. And the second line of research is the one regarding the modeling of excitation energy transfer phenomena, which basically corresponds to a chromophore in the system being excited and the energy of this chromophore being passed to another chromophore in the system. Usually these phenomena are treated using a Foster-like theory, and it's the same thing that we are doing in our lab. And the rates of this transfer are computed using this formula that I'm not sure you can read, but it's basically proportional to the square of the coupling between the transition densities of the two chromophores. And in our lab, we use a state-of-the-art approach to compute this coupling, which exploits the full quantum mechanical transition densities of the two chromophores, and also take into account the response of the environment to these transition densities. Eventually, more recent research has been carried out to model more complex environments in which a continuum picture cannot be applied straightforwardly. And in particular, an extension of the PCM model has been done in order to couple it with a classical but polarizable force field, which is very useful when one wants to model heterogeneous environment like in a protein environment, and but keeping every ingredient in the system fully polarized. When you combine the MMPOL description with the capability of computing EET rates, then you become suddenly able to model light harvesting proteins. And this is the current main line of research in the Molecular Lab. And these kind of proteins, I will just make a short digression, are very interesting natural systems. And basically, they are the responsible for the first step in natural photosynthesis. So they are the responsible for capturing solar light and funneling through EET processes towards the reaction centers. Contrary to natural photosynthesis, which is not very efficient, the light harvesting step is incredibly efficient. And we have a lot to learn from light harvesting proteins. And so it's a very interesting field of research. Of course, when you add to the two capabilities that I've described, the possibility to model metal particles, then you suddenly become able to treat biohybrid devices in which your protein now is coupled with a plasmonic system that enhances the optical properties of your light harvesting device. And this can be very useful in the development of devices for photosynthesis or photovoltaics. And it's not just that we have the capabilities to treat these kind of systems, but they are very interesting from an experimental point of view. And in fact, experimentalists started to play with these two ingredients before of us. And in particular, I'm going to show you the results of our simulations that try to reproduce the experiments of Makowski and co-workers on a system composed by silver island film. So you have clusters of silver, on top of which you deposited, they deposited the PCP protein, which is a peridinin chlorophyll protein. This is an antenna protein, which is one of the different proteins responsible for light harvesting, in which you have eight carotenoids in red and two chlorophylls. So on the right, you can see the experimental absorption and emission spectrum of the system, which is characterized by a broad band corresponding to the carotenoid absorption, while the emission is only coming out from the chlorophyll. So you have an excitation energy transfer from the carotenoids to the chlorophyll in the system. The experimentalist studied two different processes, a direct process which only involved the chlorophyll. So you excite the chlorophyll and look at the light coming out of the chlorophyll. And the second process, which I will call as EET process, in which the carotenoids are excited and then the light is coming out of the chlorophyll again. So the experimental results basically find a strong enhancement of the light harvesting of the fluorescence properties of the PCP protein. And in particular, they found an enhancement, an average enhancement of sixfold for the EET process, but with a maximum enhancement of up to 20 times. And so we are trying to see if we can see similar enhancements in our simulations. The work recently appeared on NanoLetters, and on the left there are some of the computational details. We basically treated three different kinds of metal aggregates, simple sphere or more elongated aggregates, because these show different plasmonic properties. And for the same reason, we also studied combinations of these metal aggregates, so pairs of aggregates, all the possible pairs coming from these three. And I will show you results on the direct process, on the EET process, once you keep the orientation of the protein fixed and you look at the fluorescence enhancement as a function of the distance between the protein and the surface. And then I will show some results on the orientational effects. But these results are only computed for the simpler and more symmetric case of a single sphere aggregate. So for the direct process, what we see is that, so in this case, we are only exciting the chlorophyll, and the chlorophyll is emitting. We see that we have strong enhancements even for the single aggregates. We see enhancement from a factor of 2 to a factor of 20 at the optimal distance of about 10 nanometers. When you consider pairs of aggregates, we see even larger enhancements, orders of magnitudes. But in this case, we have to point out that even though these enhancements were not found experimentally, these configurations are very unlikely to happen in a real experiment because we have the chlorophyll placed, so the protein placed exactly in the middle of two pairs of aggregates with the chlorophyll axis oriented in the optimal way. So statistically, these are not significant, but in an effort to propose design rules, these can be the maximum enhancement obtainable for this kind of systems for the direct process. Ah, sorry. Another thing to notice is that for the pairs of aggregates, we have almost a monotonic behavior when you consider more elongated aggregates, and this corresponds, can be rationalized in terms of the plasmonic properties of these aggregates, which have a maximum, which have a resonance, which come closer and closer to the frequencies where these processes happen. When we look at the EET process, things get more complicated because now we have four different channels because the carotenoids have two different states which can transfer energy to two different states. So we had to model separately two different pathways. But even when we do that, what we see is that we find enhancements which are still quite large and even though smaller than the direct case, and this is in agreement with the experiments. And also in this case, we see that we can have a very large enhancements of a factor of 50 for specific configurations. And we can somehow rationalize the experimental results by considering that the highest enhancements come from these plasmonic hotspot regions, but in which the protein is placed probably in not the optimal configuration. In all these results, I haven't looked at the orientation effect, which are instead reproduced here. So when we look on the left, there is the results for the direct process. On the right, the results for the EET processes. And what we saw is that is quite interesting is the fact that the direct process can be more efficiently enhanced, but can also be quenched for specific orientation very easily, while the EET processes that involve more steps are more robust against quenching, even though they cannot achieve the same level of enhancement. To conclude, I haven't stressed enough the real nice features of our model, which also allow us to separately look at each contribution and understand in which step the metal is making the difference in our system. But of course, the main the crucial ingredients are also the fact that we can have an excitonic description of the carotenoids, so all the different carotenoids in the system were treated explicitly in computing these excited state properties. And we have realistic couplings, and we have a full control on the design of the geometry and on the different possibilities. And we have done a systematic study of different effects on the system. Of course, there are some limitations, which are actually part of the work that I'm carrying on in these days. And I want to thank you again all for attending my presentation.
There is space for some questions.
Just a quick question as a curiosity. When you mentioned that you have a realistic coupling in the excitation energy transfer, since the process is not only electronic, do you mean that you're coupling the electronic states with the nuclear motions or not?
No.
So no. This is all...
No, and the realistic means that is above the dipole approximation typical of Foster theory, and that also includes the... a response in the electrostatic interaction due to the environment.
But is there any time for nuclear relaxation? I mean, it should be experimentally.
Well, I'm not... well, I mean, some of these processes are very fast. Some of them are actually coherent, so they cannot be described using a force-like theory. In this case, well, I think that the nuclear motion is somehow approximated in the force-like equation. And we are working on a more, well, we still have to start working on a more realistic description of the dynamic of the excited states, but this hasn't started yet. But there is room for improvement on that direction. Yes.
You were mentioning the approximations in treating the states of carotenoids. Now, I think you were thinking to the fact that the first excited state is mainly a double excitation.
Yes.
So how did you treat it? How could you compute the coupling?
So this is like a very nasty question in the sense that it's true that the S1 state of these carotenoids is dark for experimentalists and also for DFT and semi-empiricals as well. What we did, so we were lucky enough to have some benchmark calculations obtained with a multi-reference kind of approach that gave us the insight on the fact that the transition dipole moment of the S1 state is similar in magnitude to the one of the S2 state. It's similar in direction to the S2 state, but it has is a factor of three, or between a factor of two and a factor of three smaller than the S2 state. And so what we did was to compute, to assume that couplings computed using the S2 state could be just rescaled to take into account this difference. And well, there is one more ingredient, in fact. The point is that if you look at the, so the S2 states are excitonic, so they are strongly coupled because all these carotenoids are very close by in this molecule, and the coupling are strong, and so you need to have all four molecules to describe this excited state, and we consider this explicitly. But then when we look at the S1 states, since the coupling between them is much smaller, they can be considered as localized in each single carotenoid. When we computed the transfer rate from the S1 to the chlorophyll, we computed actually the transfer rate of the individual S2 states to the chlorophyll, and then rescaled these transfer rates. So this is like a farther step.